It is 7:05, so I'm going to get started and call this meeting to order and go through the agenda. So 2.0 adjustments to the agenda. Anybody in particular?
Make an appointment to be out of committee.
Yes, so we're going to have a, it's not really an action matter. We just kind of appoint.
Okay.
So we're going to have a quick discussion matter about the audit when we get there. So that'll be 6.2. We'll just call it that. 6.2 audit. 3.0 audience and communications.
I'm good.
You know, if you're gonna come, you gotta come with something.
It's 7 p.m. Yeah,
there you go. 4.0 presentations. We have one presentation scheduled this evening. It's literacy, K to 8. Take it away.
I think I should introduce myself. Yeah. I actually know everybody.
Yes.
So I'm Shannon Spellman. I am the literacy specialist in Charlotte, and Stephanie and I are going to do academic programming for literacy in Charlotte. Sorry for the darkness, there's no hat. Okay, I can drive.
We wanted to start, and we'll be doing this throughout the different academic areas that we're presenting over the course of the next several months, but we wanted to start with tying back to the first presentation that Barbara Ann and I gave at the last board meeting around proficiency-based learning, and particularly looking at the connection of the first two big ideas that we presented there as they connect to our academic programming at CCS, with the first big idea being that in all of our programming, we're committed to all students reaching or exceeding proficient levels of learning, and that within proficiency-based learning and within our programming, we're making a shift from a focus on what we teach to a focus on what students learn. We also will keep bringing this graphic of the CSSU mission into the work that we do, knowing that this is really our North Star and that we're working, you know, as part of a pre-K-12 system within our K-8 now building. The CSSU mission was recently updated to be inclusive of the transferable skills that connect to CVU's proficiency-based graduation standards, and in planning for instruction and in working with our students, our teachers are really engaging in this work as well. So tonight, the way we chose to go about talking about literacy in our K-8 building is to go through a journey of examples. So looking at two particular anchor standards within the Common Core standards. An anchor standard for writing, which is a standard that really spans our K-8 instruction, producing clear and coherent writing in which the development, organization, and style are appropriate to task, purpose, and audience. That's something that students are constantly learning about and progressing through in their entire education. And then the literacy anchor standard that we're using as our example is that students will analyze the structure of texts, including how specific sentences, paragraphs, and larger portions of the text, like a section or a chapter or a scene, relate to each other and to the whole of the text.
I'm just gonna ask, does everyone know what the anchor standards are for the Common Core? Or does anyone want a little explanation about what those mean?
I'll take it.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So what the anchor standards are is the Common Core has anchor standards in each content area. So they have it for writing, they have it for reading. And what they are the end point. So it's the Common Core, the acronym right there is Common Core State Standards for ELA Literacy. And then it's College and Career Readiness Anchor Standard Writing, and that's the fourth one. So if our kids are college and career ready at the end of the Common Core, that's where they will be. So for our building, the Common Core in general, each standard kind of uses backwards design where this is where we want them to be, how are we going to get them there? And each grade level then has specific standards that relate to those. So there's a writing standard number 4 for 4th grade. There's a writing standard number 4 for 5th grade. And it all builds to get to these two quote-unquote end points. So you can see that these two anchor standards tie really nicely with the proficiency-based graduation requirements that you just saw in that tiny little leaf format.
And so our teachers are not only using these to work with how students learn at their own grade level, but also with progressions. Our teachers are working across several grade levels because that helps us address issues of rigor, increasing rigor, maybe decreasing rigor, increasing the complexity of what students are working with, or decreasing the complexity, because we know that in any given grade level, we will have a wide range of students as writers and readers. And so working with the progressions and having the knowledge of how these anchor standards and these endpoints progress from our earliest readers and writers to what the intended outcome is work that our teachers are engaged in all the time.
So we're going to talk a little bit about K2, and then we'll move through the grades. And K2 we broke a little bit differently, but one kind of theme we'd like you to see is how things build on each other over time. So what we're going to do is talk a little bit about reading, and what you see on the right is a bookmark that our K2 teachers sort of created together last year and the year before, and we've been working with the kids on. And what you'll notice is the front is where it says reading is thinking. And what we talk a lot about in kindergarten through second grade is there's a real range of where kids come to us and where kids are. But what we need to be able to teach them is that reading is thinking. They need to understand the text, whether they are listening to it or whether they're reading it on their own. With that being said, there is also this component to you need to actually learn how to decode at the most basic level. You need to understand that print carries a message. You need to understand that letters capture sounds, and when put together in a particular order, you can decode many of those by using patterns that you've learned, but there are other words that you just kind of have to know, and the patterns that you learn to break apart words as you read them increases over time. Different kids are jumping in there at different points, and different kids also need different instruction to match that. So for reading, what we really talked about is how can we ensure that all of our kindergarten, first, and second graders have this thorough understanding that what you're doing when you're reading is you're creating meaning, and if you don't have meaning, you need to stop. So we came up with the front part, which is this idea that reading is meaning. And you always have to ask yourself these questions. Does what I'm reading make sense? And if it doesn't, you need to stop and do something about it. In the beginning, you're also looking at, does it look right and does it sound right? And what that means is, if I'm looking at the word cat and I say dog, I need to know that dog doesn't start with a k, and I need to do something about it. And then, does it sound right? I need to make sure that as I'm reading, my sentences sound like sentences. That front part is really trying to get the kids to think about their own learning, and when meaning breaks down, for them to stop. Now, we also know they're really young, or as they're learning these progressions, they might not know what to do when it doesn't make sense. And that's this back part. So these are these reading strategies that we are teaching kids in class and really trying to support them outside of class and across their content areas. We're really getting this idea, if something doesn't make sense, here's some strategies that you can do. So this bookmark is used in different ways, but as teachers, we try to really be concise with what we're all working on for kids. And we've actually been able to send this home with certain kids and grades, and we teach it throughout really kindergarten first and hold kids accountable for a second. Okay. Another area that we're going to talk about is word study. In our school, we use the Foundations program, K12. The Foundations program is a great research-based program that has a really clear scope and sequence. This year, we are trying to address the fact that there is a really clear scope and sequence, and at the same time, not everyone goes through this progression at the same time. We have an opportunity right now, and this is the first grade work that I'm going to speak to, but we're actually doing this in kindergarten first and second. What we're using is we're using our new time for looking at student work, and what we're going to do is we're actually going to work on differentiating word study to better match the needs of our kids during their WIN block. So in kindergarten, first and second, we have 3 half-hour periods where we have an opportunity to break the kids up and really think about what they need based on this trajectory that Foundations gives us, and then also we can fall back on these great research-based strategies for instruction. So one of the things that we are doing with this is we are looking at recent data, looking at what the kids have on a whole, what the whole group kind of needs, and then we're breaking them out into more targeted subgroups that last for a set period of time. That group does not put you in a trajectory that if you're in group one, you're going to stay in group one. What it does is it says, here are the skills. Who has what? Let's teach to those skills, and let's not hold kids back if they have them already. And we are trying to work on the extension piece, which really, for word study, is that in kindergarten, first and second, is that idea of you're going to write words based on these patterns that you might not have real control over, but we're not going to limit what we write based on the spelling.
Okay. Before you move on to the next slide, because there's a connection here, and in going back to the last presentation on proficiency-based learning, our teachers are working with learning targets and learning scales, and our students are working with learning targets quite a bit. It's a very regular part of their experience, and the learning scales are becoming more a part of what students are using in the classroom as well. And we talked a lot last time about how the brain works and how the brain learns, and we know that when students know what the target is and when they know what they're supposed to be learning and they know what they're supposed to be doing during a set amount of time, that it increases their success, it increases their engagement, it makes them more ready for the instruction. So the learning scale, the shaded area of 3, is what proficient would look like for this particular learning target, and we've thought beyond that as well. So for students who are proficient there, where are we going next with that group of students? What that might look like in the classroom is on this next slide, where in kindergarten, this picture captures a writer's workshop time for our kindergartners, and the core idea was introduced out loud to students, it's introduced in print, it's brought up over and over again during that writing block. It's a key part of the instruction that what the core idea for that focused writing lesson was is writers make pictures in their mind. Sometimes they close their eyes and picture the topic they want to write about and then put all the details into pictures and words. And you'll see how a similar core idea might progress over time. Another example with kindergarten is answering a prompt with a full telling sentence. So moving beyond using picture details, and as they're getting into writing skills, responding to a specific prompt, perhaps for a specific audience, to target that same core idea.
Do a lot of writing about what matters to them, and we do a lot of thinking about, is this a story from your own life? Is this something that you're trying to write to inform? Is this an opinion? Those are the 3 main text types in the Common Core that we're expected to instruct, and they start as young as kindergarten. Moving on to first grade, here are examples of how students are working to create robust narratives, or those ideas of stories that are true about your own life. And in first grade, the idea is that kids are supposed to be able to recount 2 or more appropriately sequenced events and including some details. So you can already see we've got kids coming to us who might not know all their letters, and we've got kids coming to us who know all 26 letters, have sight words, and are ready to go. And they're all in kindergarten, and they're all moving ahead. And we're really trying to get kids to extend their reading and their writing and their application of that. And then thinking in second grade, these are also personal narratives. Now what's changed is the length, the text complexity for some of these kiddos. What you're also starting to see, and I wish this picture captured it a little bit more, is that author's craft is really apparent in these. So these were this year's second graders, and they did personal narratives that were multiple pages. They included quotations, they included dialogue, and spontaneously, based on the reading instruction that they've had, so many of these students decided to write about the authors. Now, that wasn't part of the narrative process. That being said, they know that oftentimes they're about the author, so they chose to do it. The other thing that was pretty amazing about this work is this was an opportunity for our second graders who are really deeply embedded in a lot of work around author's craft in reading, to come together across the grade. And we had cross grade level partnership conversations where the job of the student was to identify two or more author craft moves the student did in each of these. And they were not only able to do it, they exceeded the expectations to be able to identify two different text moves the author did. That being said, our second grade team also just was awarded two different grants for over $800 altogether to get at, they're working with new units in writing, or reading, excuse me, to enhance the units of writing, and they're really finding some great things with it. And so they just went out and did two grants, one through the PTO and one through the NEA, so we're so thankful about that.
We were just gonna add, is this is just really nice evidence of the connection through all the literacy.
Yeah.
A lot of what drove this was what was actually happening in reader workshops,
yeah,
where students were working with mentor texts, both at specific instructional levels through read aloud, through teacher modeling, author craft moves with read aloud, small reading groups, but then also students working with what was in their book box that they're reading at, their own independent level with, and being able to share with someone who might be reading at a different level, here's the book I'm reading, here's what it's about, here are the author moves that made this happen in the story, and then transferring it into their own writing.
So speaking of author's craft, our third and fourth grade, in the beginning of the year, we have our assessment system where we really look at every student, and then we have data reviews. And this year, what our third and fourth grade teams, when we did data review for literacy, we looked at where the group strengths are, where the group challenges are, and then we did look at individual students. But one of the kind of things that popped out at us when we were starting to look at what's called our benchmark assessment system information is that our kiddos needed a little bit more help with author's craft, which is absolutely developmentally appropriate. This is this point of authors really make decisions about what they say and what they want to convey to you. And they won't always tell it to you in a direct way. You've got to start bringing what you know about characters, about bringing what you know about the story. You've got to start putting things together. And so what we started to think about is what tools and resources can we use? So again, we went back to, well, oh, we have some learning progressions. We've got such a range of ability levels, and we want to make sure that we have really clear understanding of what it looks like so that we are able to match the needs of the students. So that's what's on the left. On the right, they have been engaged, this is fourth grade now, has been engaged with a read aloud, which is a great opportunity for teacher modeling of working through author's craft and what does it look like. And they've done a lot with nonfiction, but I wanted to use this fiction It's a book called Escape from Baxter's Barn, and it goes with their Vermont History Unit, so it connects with their social studies. It also connects with their reading, and this chart right here shows what's called the arc of the story, and it's this idea of how the author is progressing through this book. What they did is they chose the arc of the story because that actually is the next explicit instruction in writing. So what they wanted to do was show how this text went through this author's craft that then they're going to learn how to do and actually be able to apply at their own level.
The writing in grades 3 and 4 also gets much more complex. We have students writing for different audiences and different purposes. And when I think back to how Shannon was showing how they're reading, that example from reading was very much embedded in their Vermont Studies unit. This is also really that nice connection back to transferable skills, where we have these kids constantly working around the area of informed and integrative thinking and pulling together different types of information, different types of evidence to support them making sense of what they're reading, but also producing their own thoughts in published writing. Mm-hmm. So what you're seeing here are a couple of different examples of students writing for different purposes and taking evidence from multiple sources throughout their Vermont Studies unit so far, which included readings that they had done, research that they had done, and also field trips. Students work through writing multiple drafts at this point. Students are doing flash drafts where there's quick getting their ideas out on paper, then they're working back through the skills that they've been focusing on in their instruction and working through to the point of publication for a specific audience.
So thinking about fourth grade now, one of the things that our fourth grade team also discovered is we just did what's called the on-demand, which is part of our assessment system. And in third through eighth grade, the on-demand is think of a topic that you have strong feelings about and you need to write about it in one sitting. And what we score every single person based on this learning progressions rubric. So we know where we want them, but we also want to make sure we're capturing where they are and having next steps. And what we found for our fourth graders is their claims or their ability to kind of state that opinion or topic needed a little work. It's one part of this, but it's an important part. So what they talked a lot about is let's use our win time to differentiate instruction in order to make sure everyone is proficient or beyond. So again, they created this learning scale where green is where we would like them to be. We used the on-demand and the assessment information that we got from that to group kiddos in a short-term, flexible group in order to meet them where they are. And the cool thing is we actually are going beyond the standard and we are working in a writing club, which has been an interesting thing. So it'll be great to see where that goes. Oops, sorry, wrong button. Okay.
Moving on into middle grades and into fifth grade, one of the ways that we really start to differentiate and address students working with different levels of rigor and complexity is often through varying the texts that they're reading, but also varying what they're doing with the text, how they're responding to it, and giving them more choice in how they respond to it and what they're focusing on within the text. Our fifth graders actually just presented this at our all-school meeting, but just completed a whole class read of The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind, which was paired with an engineering design that they did, bringing in some math and science. And their topic was gratitude and looking at it from this story, The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind, and comparing his life in Malawi to their life here in Charlotte. And they had several gratitude themes that they could choose from to respond to and pull out specific evidence from the text to then be stating their opinion,
developing some writing about it. They actually produced a video where they were working on speaking skills, and that was shared at all school meeting. And then the grid in the other picture is also a method of feedback that our students are getting. So our students are sharing their writing with each other as it develops. They're working on, you know, this is a work in progress. They're working through some protocols to get feedback, not only from their teachers, but from each other. And then they're going back and using that feedback to redraft, to maybe go back in and find more evidence. So the gratitude themes is actually one student's text evidence that she pulled out, and the two themes that she chose to focus on were food and education. And we saw across the grade, the students really vary in what they chose. Some were very focused on school, some very focused on economy, technology. So giving them a lot of choice also opens up how they can engage with the text and then engage in their writing beyond that.
So in fifth grade, we had that K2 bookmark, and hopefully you saw how that built on itself and it built into 3-4. Fifth grade is where we introduce something that is introduced in fifth grade and is built up through eighth grade. And what it is, it's these close reading strategies for fiction. And this comes from a book called Notice and Note by Kylene Beers and Robert Probst, I think his name, Provost. Sorry, I'm gonna get that wrong. But this is this idea, and they're explicitly taught in fifth grade, that if you are reading a fictional story, there are almost always these really particular author craft moves that when you notice them, you need to stop and do something. So an example that I'm gonna give you guys is this one called Memory Moment. And it's this idea that there might be a memory that keeps coming back in a story, and I think we've all read stories about this. But what we're trying to work with kids is you need to stop when this memory comes out and kind of ask yourself, why might this memory be important? So this might seem like, of course you need to do this, but what we're finding is a lot of kids don't really know how to do that. But once we share with them the author's craft, they're not only doing it, they're applying it, and they're creating more signposts. So we work through these six particular signposts, and we teach them explicitly in fifth grade in order to get a really deep understanding. Because what this is going to get at is it's going to really start to help you with themes, conflict, foreshadowing, and all that inferential comprehension that can be really tricky when you start getting into the double and triple layers of language.
That work continues in through 6 through 8, but grade 6 does a great deal of intentional application and follow-up instruction and revisiting the notice and note close reading strategies. And what you're seeing with that is also a bookmark that was developed by the team last year, where students, the reading groups in sixth grade tend to be very much aligned with the social studies curriculum as a way to supplement and bring literature into working with fictional accounts of history and matching that up with the nonfiction and the actual history that they're working with. It also allows us to address the wide range of readers that we have in sixth grade, and they're working around the same theme, but they might be working at different text levels and different levels of complexity. This is also pushing students toward more independent application and practice in looking for those moments in books and being very careful readers and really being metacognitive in their work, to actually go in and be reading for information and also reading like a detective. And they know that they're looking for these things and that that will help them make meaning. And it also comes back into the discussions that they're having in their book groups. Students are bringing back all different kinds of evidence from the book because there are multiple opportunities to find that evidence in their books. And they're sharing that out with each other and building a wider body of knowledge around the text that they're sharing.
It gives a really great common language for kids who may be engaged in really different reading. and it gives you a common language that you can talk, so it enables us to differentiate in a different way.
We skipped the last
one. Oh, did I skip one?
I think.
That one?
We might have lost a slide on the way here.
That's the way here. Oh, we did.
We did.
That's we lost right. Our social media slide. Yeah. Oh, wait, no. We did. We left two slides. Oh, there we go.
Okay.
Sorry, everyone.
The beginning of this year, grade six did a lot of work around opinion writing, and their on demand was what Shannon had described that grades 3 through 8 all engage in, where they're picking a topic that they're very passionate about and employing skills of opinion writing that they've been working on. But the sixth grade this year took that much deeper, and there was a read aloud.
Sorry, just jumped. I thought that was what you wanted. Sorry. Right.
There was a read aloud that the whole class did called The Revealers by Doug Wilhelm, and it was very much connected with the Sweethearts and Heroes presentation that we brought to the school this year, which was an anti-bullying presentation that was hugely impactful for our middle level kiddos, for all of our kiddos. They attended the Flynn performance of The Incredible Speediness of Jamie Cavanaugh. They had also been engaged in reading the thing about jellyfish, which also talks about bullying and social dynamics. And then they're reading currently The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Teens, which is nonfiction, and it's talking about skills that they can develop to really confront some of the things that have come up in all of these different pieces of evidence and text they've been working with, but also to become better students. And so currently their in-class writing focus is now on how can being different lead to misunderstandings. So they've moved beyond writing opinion for a choice topic to being assigned a prompt and needing to pull from those 5 different pieces of evidence to support the claim that they make to respond to that prompt.
Hopefully this next one's smarter. Is that the one?
Is that B? This is an example of writing coming from our Omega students from the on-demand writing prompt, where they are picking something that they have very strong feelings about and opinions and writing it in one sitting. So this is an on-demand assessment. They do have opportunity to think about what they will write about, to gather their own research, to gather their own evidence. And we just clipped out the first 2 paragraphs of this student's writing. It's a really good example of looking at how all of this opinion writing and writing claims and developing these skills leads up to students writing with a much deeper complexity in terms of their use of vocabulary, their use of writer's voice, how they're using punctuation very purposefully, when they're posing questions to the readers, when they're inserting phrases versus full sentences, and then how they're bringing in argument, and it goes on to bring in counter argument with different pieces of evidence supporting their own argument and what the counter argument that somebody who disagrees with them might offer, eventually leading to their closing, which comes back to support their claim.
Looks a little different than fourth grade, right? Like, definitely changing.
This is another piece of work that the Omega students have been engaged in, which again supports the opinion writing, and it's coming up with this I believe statements. So again, tapping into middle schoolers really having their own opinions, their own belief systems, their own passions, but using that as a catalyst to work with very specific skills. And so this learning scale is around a common core standard of making a claim about something and being able to support it with specific evidence.
So we talked about author's craft and reading strategies over the course of the grades so far, and we've talked about fiction strategies. One thing that our middle level did last year was the literacy committee came together and we talked about kids are asked to read different articles, different nonfiction, different chapters for all sorts of different content areas once they start to get middle school and beyond. It happens before middle school, but this is really when they're starting to ask themselves or being asked to do it independently. So what we really wanted to give them was tools that they could use in order to have to understand anything that's presented to them, even if they don't have much background knowledge on it. So what we thought a lot about is, if you are closely reading, what are you doing? How are you leaving these tracks for yourself? How are you writing notes? What are you working on in order to bring meaning to this text that you might not understand? So we started to think about this in, we started to think about it as a grade level way, and then we realized being able to closely read different articles isn't necessarily grade specific. But once you can do it, I can change the article in front of you and I can make it more complex, less complex, whatever I need to do. But here are the strategies that you can employ to do it independently to thoroughly understand. So we created this rubric for kids to see what it is that will help them understand anything that's put in front of them. And this is just one example. And so here is going back to those signposts and how they're used in seventh and eighth grade. What we want you to see is they're doing a reading response, so it's a book that they're reading. They're being asked to pick a signpost, and then they're asked to respond to it in a particular format, which is called the LEAF. LEAF stands for Lead, Evidence, Analysis, Finisher. So again, it's going to go back to all of those things, all of those strategies we've talked about, but this is really trying to be concise in what you say for the purpose of a particular audience. So the color coding is actually the lead, the evidence, the analysis, and the finisher. That particular strategy of a LEAF paragraph extends through high school as well. That is K-8 literacy in a half hour and not 15 minutes. So we're sorry that took a little longer, but it's a big topic.
No, that's fantastic. Thank you. I'll open it up. Does anybody have a particular question?
I have a question. So in the event that a child is unable to master a learning target, And even with additional teacher assistance helping him or her along the way, what resources do we have to help that student progress? Because you've laid out so well how this is really a building block process, and if something goes awry in any as you move through this process, it's obviously going to affect their abilities to master targets moving forward. So I'm just wondering about additional resources for students in that situation.
So actually, I'm going to add on to that because my question was about sort of the same thing. If you could talk about that as well as how it looks in the classroom, differentiating between students, how that gets decided, and then what resources are brought to the table on both ends of the spectrum.
I would say that's one of the pieces that proficiency-based learning is really helping us with. So the first thing I thought of when Jeff started his question was backup targets. For some students, you know, we have our trajectories, our progressions, we have our curriculum and our standards, but and we also know that we might have kids coming to us that are not ready to approach those standards. So when we're looking at progressions, we might be working back several grade levels in looking at where in the progression of this entire standard is that student and starting to create backup targets for that. And so then the classroom teachers are working with each other. I would say there's a tremendous amount of collaboration across teams, across grade level teams, in our cohorts, you know, our 1-2 teachers working together, also working with Shannon, with the special educator on the team, and looking at, for that specific student or group of students, what are our available text resources, what are our available staff resources, what does the instruction look like, who's the best qualified. Now we talk, and that's the teaming and the win block right now, employing all of those adults at the same time for targeted instruction is one way that we address that. And it might be that, it may not be
the special educator necessarily that is the one that's the best resource or the only resource there. It might be that it's the literacy specialist. It might be that it's the classroom teacher because they're coming in with a very strong background around literacy. I'll let you speak more.
Well, I'm thinking the other system that really starts to come into play is our multi-tiered system of supports. So we have data reviews for all of our grade levels in literacy and in math, and this year we've started to do behavior, which is great. And we really dive into the information that we have for the particular groups and say, what is their strength, what is their challenge as a group, and then we go to the individual level. Sometimes all it takes is us looking and saying, you know, they really don't have this. Here are some strategies for how we can do that. Sometimes they're as small as, you know, it's really hard for them to come up with them, and I'm going to use examples of things that came up in data review this year, where this particular student really has a hard time coming up with an idea. So the people at the door, I mean, we're all, you see us there, we're pulling that student aside more frequently and saying, hey, let's talk about this, trying to give them a little more individualized attention. At the same side, we have it on the other end, where we've got some kiddos who are doing a really great job and they're ready for more. And so part of our discussions were, all right, so what can we offer them, or what questions can we ask them, or what can we give them? Something that we've started to do in first grade is we have an opportunity where we're using the take-home library in the STARS room, which is a leveled library, so it's a little different than our actual library. And it's this idea of we're bringing everybody, but we're guiding you to where you should be in order to push yourself in a really appropriate way. So the multi-tiered system of support starts to come in because we'll start to use data to look at who really needs more than what we're providing in the classroom, or what accommodations can we start to provide in the classroom to keep you moving along your path. That being said, all of our learning progressions, not every student is going to hit every single one. Some people might skip, and you might come back, and you might go forward. But really, they have a really strong conversation around them. That answers it.
And then where do parents fit in to that, as far as if that child is, you know, the targeted level of reading books in the STARS room, the take-home library?
Yeah.
You know, how's all this kind of communicated to families, or is it not? Is it something that families don't need to know? Or?
Well, for kiddos who are going to receive intervention support, they won't receive STARS room support unless a parent is contacted. And the hope, and it's always contacted by the classroom mm-hmm. teacher, because they have the best relationship, and the classroom teacher always explains, give Shannon a call. More than happy to meet with absolutely anyone. I've actually met with people who are receiving support, and then I've also been part of classroom parent-teacher conferences for parents who are concerned that their child isn't getting as much as they need. That being said, we always have to be really thoughtful when we're working with our kids that they don't identify themselves as a level or something along those lines. Because the truth is, on these progressions, and I hope the signpost kind of highlighted this, is these skills are found across content areas and across books, and we really need to get our kids thinking deeply about them, but hopefully our parents are well informed mm-hmm. about how their kids are doing before a report card comes home.
And I would say much of that happens with regular parent communication, mm-hmm. parent conferences. I also think about the students who kind of tap out the classroom library because mm-hmm. they're reading at very high levels. And we do have the STARS room library,
yeah.
but we also have a tremendous resource in Heidi Huestis,
amazing.
Our librarian. You know, and our teachers are tapping her all of the time. You know, we've got this span of levels in the classroom. These are the themes we're working on. What books can you pull? What can you send us toward? And they're also giving those recommendations to parents, because we don't want kids to get bored. We want them to keep reading. We want them to keep reaching as readers.
She is a great, great resource. I'm thinking another thing that came up at one of our data reviews is we have a group of kids who just really aren't engaged in independent reading, and we're concerned about it because, like running, you need mileage in reading to some degree. And so we started to talk, and she's got books in her back pocket that she's mm-hmm. going to look directly at certain kiddos and be like, oh my gosh, you, Eric, you would love this book, to really try to get that buy-in, and that came from the conversations for data review and knowing that Heidi's got a great relationship. But it's really trying to get at the individual's strengths to work through their challenges, and that's going to go across all proficiencies.
I guess I have a question about sort of when they leave our school. So, you know, some of these standards are college ready. Are you getting feedback from the high school level about their level of preparation in different facets of literacy? And I'm thinking in particular maybe about, you seem to convey that there was a lot of emphasis on being able to read fiction and understand what the authors are trying to communicate or what the arc of the story might be. On the other side of the spectrum, sort of the being able to craft an argument that's well-structured, well-organized, appropriate grammar, you know, really robust sort of attention to those conventions and details. And what kind of strategies, maybe I'm thinking 7th and 8th grade, I don't know, like as they're getting close to high school, are they equipped to function at that level?
Yeah, so we chose fiction. We easily could have done nonfiction as well. There was a lot to cover. I will say that at, let me back up. Your question was about how we had any feedback from the high school. And honestly, I have not. I have had feedback from the other end where the kids that we're most concerned with, I've had feedback about are we recommending the right kids into that particular program. We've gotten a lot of really good feedback about that. That being said, I'm thinking about the two students, the vice president and the president of the student body this year who spoke at our welcoming ceremonies where all of the teachers through the SU get together and Elaine talks and different people talk. They were both Charlotte graduates and they both spoke about the debates that happen in 7-8 and just how much it prepared them to do exactly what you're asking. So you've got to not only talk about evidence and claims and really getting a good claim, choosing your evidence and being able to analyze and think about counter-arguments, but you have to be able to articulate that in writing, sometimes in long passages, other times not so much. So you've got to think about how succinct you need to be and how deeply you're going to go with your analysis. But then they also do a lot with those debates in 7-8. And it was just amazing to see the high school students talk about that as they're really trying to say thank you to the teachers and get us excited. So it was really cool to see. So they do work on it.
And what I would add, knowing that you asked specifically about middle level, while we've focused on fiction, right after our teachers did a book study of Notice and Note for fiction, the same authors published Notice and Note for nonfiction. And so our middle level teachers across all content areas did a lunchtime book study of that. Mm-hmm. And so then there was the development of materials and working with students around reading for nonfiction, and that those are being employed in social studies, in science. There are some pieces of that happening in math because we have students writing claims in math also and backing up with evidence.
And we actually almost included something that is happening in 7-8 math, which goes to what you're saying. We're really thinking about how to back up your claim with particular evidence. And Nancy Matthews did an amazing job and is working on it with 7-8. And we chose not to include it because, one, it was
probably
getting too long. And you'll probably see it in science.
Thanks.
Cool. Anything else, anybody? Thank you. It was excellent. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shannon.
So moving on, reports to the board. 5.1, the principal's report. Do you want to highlight anything in particular?
So there are two things I'd like to highlight.
Sure.
So two things that were mentioned in the previous presentation, I just want to highlight that also are mentioned here, just so I can help make the connections. So one is about the MTSS initiative. We've talked about that at different times. And pretty much the summary is that we're implementing the first step of the Guiding Principles for Instruction and Intervention, which is a CSSU document that was created collaboratively within this SU. And our focus has been building collaboration and coherence. We had identified three major steps to that process. One was streamlining our student information and data and resources, so there would be like one-stop shopping for everybody to find the information that they need about students. We'd also, number two, would have collaborative team time focused on differentiating instruction. And the third one was providing students with time called what I need, win time. You heard that referenced there, where there'd be more than one teacher available to support that differentiation. So all three are up and running, all three parts. We're really pleased with what's happening across the school, the conversations that teachers are having around instruction. That in and of itself, where people are talking about instruction, moves people and moves practices. So it's the embedded PD that we've talked about that's really key. We are in the fourth week, or even just a little beyond the fourth week now, of collaborative team time. We had talked about we would have facilitators who are the coaches playing that role as facilitators, and then we provide them training in it. They have completed now four days of training in how to facilitate, and so those are moving along, I'd say, as or better than expected. Win times are just beginning, and you'll be getting to hear more about that. I'm going to move on to the next.
Barbara Ann, so yes. Win time is a time for a team of teachers to come together and do what they need now?
So specifically, you have the two teachers on a team available where they are sharing students, and they have determined during their collaborative team time what students need based on looking at student work. And they've decided, oh, this is what some students need, and we're going to together provide that along with the support from the special educator as well as with the support of one of the coaches. So you have four people supporting two classrooms around what students need, and kids are getting the instruction at the level that they need.
So this goes to classroom differentiation.
Differentiation. This is a model to support and grow differentiation. The other one I just wanted to highlight, again, was brought up in this past presentation, was around data reviews. And just to give you just some background around it and repeat what was also said, we have it in math, literacy, and new this year will be around behavior. And these are happening around three times a year. They're happening during team meeting time. We have moved these out of being during release time based on our commitment to decrease the amount of time that teachers are pulled out of the rooms. And these data reviews include the team teachers, special educator, the coach, and an administrator. And for each of these subject areas, math, literacy, and behavior, there are two. One that focuses on the grade level, what's going on at the big macro level, what do we see as trends and patterns based on data, and then the second one, they'll focus in more on students. So those are the two things I wanted to highlight.
Thank you very much. Questions, principal's report?
And I guess I just have to go back to behavior again, because you know the 3 years I've been on the board, well, almost, it always comes up, and it's one of those things that I think it came up in March 1 year, and then we decided to do it, have an update in December. And then the spring. So it's kind of, are we going to get an update on what's going on as far as behavior at school, or is the board going to hear anything about what's going on at the school?
If you'd like, yes.
We could do that at our next meeting, which is February.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So remember the year when we had a large audience here, maybe that was last year or the year before?
2 years ago.
Because the behavior was so bad at a certain time of year, or it had reached a critical point. So, and I guess this is part of the merger issue, is so how are we going to find out some of these things about what's really, what's happening at school when we're not, like, what's the vehicle for that communication? So February, we'll probably have a pretty packed meeting. So,
do you think it'll be different than this?
No, I mean packed agenda. Sorry, not packed with people. But I guess if behavior's on the agenda, maybe.
I don't think the agenda is going to be more packed because you haven't had 2 months of meetings. Because the work that you would have been doing in the past would have been the budget.
Would have been the budget stuff.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Would be a Steve board that would be doing that.
So let's, I don't know what a report is for February, I don't have it in front of me, but let's tag behavior in there. It is something that comes up every year, you're right. And
yeah, it's you know, yeah. in front of, we know it's going to come up.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you know. Actually, so my question was, did the window get fixed?
There is a replacement in there. The wood is now gone, and there is a replacement in there. Dave made it himself, and we're waiting the a real window to be arriving shortly.
Just so on that, you know, so yes, behavior has been an issue in the community just because there was an incident that ends up in the paper.
You know, just to the point of that it's going to be a larger board or a more centralized board, I think that that's one of those areas that the larger board, the new CVSD board might consider. Okay, so when we're developing our work plan, when might we every single year want to get a kind of an overview of what are the behavior management systems that we have and what is the data from year to year? I think it's at that level that the board would get engaged about that.
Right, yeah, and across the schools too.
Exactly.
You know, where
no,
we're
no,
having,
not just Charlotte. Yeah. It would be all the schools and then...
No, that's right. Yes. Where can we pinpoint is one particular building having a problem over another?
Yeah.
All right, we're just getting into stuff. Which actually leads a little bit to the next thing on the agenda here, which is... the 17-18 budget process, which is technically being handled by a different board. However, we've asked for a little bit of an update, just how it's going forward, feeding into the larger system.
So I wanted to give you just a sense of some things that we're thinking about and the process in general of what's going on. So as you know, that being becoming one district, the process is different now. What we have done at CCS is we have requested from staff, both through our bulletin that goes out, as well as at a staff meeting, for input in decision packets. And we're at the stage where we're collecting input, and one person worded as, we're just collecting all ideas, including the kitchen sink. It's a very inclusive process at this stage. It's not being vetted yet. So what I wanted to share with you today is some of the thinking that went in to, and some of the pieces that we're thinking about. And it's not where we are necessarily behind these at this stage. It's more of just letting you know, this is what the thinking is. And the process will be continuing similar to how it's been done for the special ed budget building process, where there is first, I guess it does happen, you put out what you wish for, and then there's a process where you really come down to the reality of how it really works within one district based on what district requests from everybody, and it becomes a collective, collaborative process that has a couple of stages to it.
Could I just jump in and give kind of the overview of how we've handled it? So we did actually parallel the service planning model, and Bob, Cindy, Jeff, Megan, and I met with each of the local administration for an hour and a half to 2 hours about a month ago. And to go over enrollments, staffing ratios, additional supports, what other programs they had that other people might not have. And we're collecting that. We're going to make a big spreadsheet with that so that we can start seeing what are the comparisons. Not to make changes in this first year, but to at least have a good picture of how it looks across the SU. And, you know, there are going to be the same kind of spreadsheets for facilities, for technology, for support materials, instructional materials, that kind of thing. So that's all behind us. We're doing that work. We've collected all the information. We're developing the spreadsheets. And we're in a place now where we're looking at people's decision packets. So this is, you didn't have this before, but now you're thinking there's a need. And that's what she's going to share with you at this point. They all shared, the principals, we were here for an all-day meeting yesterday. The principals, K-12, shared with each other and then had an opportunity to discuss with each other the decision packets that are being put forward.
So one of the thoughts that influences some of this thinking is that we did have pretty extreme cuts last year.
Yes.
And that we have no fat. The budget doesn't, the CCS budget does not have any fat. And the question that went out to staff was, where do you just feel it's just too tight? And so we collected that information. And so some of the areas where people came back with information, again, these are just being considered. These are not necessarily that we are supporting all these. So one is around to provide more wraparound social emotional support through a social worker. Another idea that's being considered is to increase our technology integrationist.
And just a reminder to us, the technology integrationist is currently
0.5.
Yeah. Okay.
One that just came up more recently from staff, and because we're still in the collecting of ideas and wanting to just be inclusive at this stage, so that's where we are, what also came up from staff is wanting to have more support for the librarian so that she can be more supportive of teachers. She's mm-hmm. been an invaluable resource.
And that's something that got cut last year.
It did. Mm-hmm. Health education, right now we have 0.2, and there is, again, teachers just giving some input that they would like to see that increased to more than 0.2. Bookkeeper, the bookkeeper also was cut last year. It is presently at 0.5, and what is being thought about is perhaps increasing it a little bit so that all the parts of the job can be managed a little more seamlessly.
Can you refresh our memory on that one a little bit, at least mine? I thought at some point we were going to have a person who was half a bookkeeper and half a
yes.
receptionist. Is that the case, or do we have two humans, each half of a person?
We currently share our bookkeeper with CSSU, so we have half a bookkeeper.
And a whole reception?
Yes, but there's less office staff overall. I'll let you...
So cost-wise, it came out to be to equal to what we were originally thinking. Originally, we thought that Martha was staying, so we were trying to increase her, and then we decreased the person at front desk. And then when she left, that resource financially was able to allow us to pay for 0.5 of a bookkeeper and a 1.0 at the front desk at an entry level.
And as far as the bookkeeper goes, does any of that system change as we merge? I mean, still need a school-based?
This is a conversation we're going to have with Bob, because yes, that's mm-hmm. the truth is we don't know. Yeah.
Another request that's being considered is to increase maintenance staff by 0.2. Just to recall, last year we cut 0.2. Having that person fill in a role that was needed in the kitchen, and this is asking that that person go back into that role. And lastly, operations and maintenance sustainability. There are three decision packets related to operations and maintenance. One is, at present, we have no money that goes into the SURF fund each year, and each year it is brought up as a request for consideration. So that is there again. Number two is to repair the roof of the 1939 building. What that comes from is the facilities committee determining that it is time for us to invest some money and to take care of that building so it does not go into further disrepair, and also believing that we'll be able to use that building and so it's worth our taking care of it. And related to that, something that's been on the list for a while is to update the library carpet.
So we'll see those coming forward in the budgeting process, or variation of that somewhere.
A variation of that. Okay. This is what's being thought about.
Do you want any input from us?
So I welcome it, but maybe not in this meeting, but instead connect with me, connect with these two, who are your representatives, so that it can be under consideration.
Is it short and concise?
It's the cross-country coach. I guess this is something that I just heard from the community. I guess there used to be a full and a part-time, and now there's just
the full.
David.
So David.
So since so many kids go out for cross country, and not gone to a meet, but it just seems like there are a lot of kids running around, one adult.
Awesome. No, that's good. I've heard that too. Thank you.
Can I ask one more question?
No.
So, is it too early in the process to know whether there's going to be further reduction in our budget this year, or if there's going to be an increase, or is that all still being determined?
It's too early, I would say, but I can almost guarantee you there's not going to be a reduction. Not past last year. But that's me talking very early in the budget process.
Okay.
As you could tell from this approach, there's no reductions that are being considered at this moment.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a process that'll determine whether how far any of these go as well.
And for those watching at home, we went through a large cutting process last year due to budgetary constraints, and that's why we're having this conversation. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Sure.
CVSD debrief. This is the new board that will operate next year. We had a meeting 2 weeks ago. Committees are being formed. The budgeting process is going forward. We had an executive session about negotiations that are upcoming this year with the teachers. CSSU debrief. The Colt report is in the packet. Anybody have any particular? The CSSU meeting right before this, actually we're going to talk about a little bit what happened there in a minute, and also the common topic was on communications with the community. Anything?
I can't remember what it was, but it was a nice presentation.
It did. 5.4, the first quarter FMR is in here. We are tracking targets. We've had a reduction in Medicaid payments, I noticed. Is that from something in particular, or do you know off the top of your head?
I do not.
I would say it's preliminary to know if that's something to be concerned about over the course of the year, because it could have something to do with either a decrease in student need, or it's just we bill back, and we might not be up to date on our bill back. So we keep an eye on it over the course of the year, and if we need to be worried about it.
Awesome.
What kinds of services are eligible for Medicaid reimbursement?
So a variety of them, but the bulk of them are personal care services for students who need one-on-one support. Speech and language services can be reimbursable or billable. Some kinds of special educator services, nursing services. Mm-hmm. Lots of services provided to special ed eligible students. Not always, but most of the time. Uh-huh.
Any other questions? 5.5, facilities. I am going to put that off as well, because we're going to talk about that more in action matters. You heard Barbara talk about the roof of the building. We'll talk about that more too. The 39 building. 6.0, discussion matters. Board corner. Chris swore I heard somebody say they were going to write an article right here. Anybody?
So you saw Sue's
I did.
Note.
Yes.
So she's trying to get her article published, or maybe it...
So it ran in last
ran,
paper.
I missed it then. Okay.
I know you had one topic on your
and
mind.
I met with the school counselors last week.
Okay.
And so I'm writing that now and hope to finish it soon.
Our school counselors, Vicki and Kathy Batty, both had a presentation at their Vermont Board Association meeting. I was not able to attend, but it was received quite well.
Yeah.
So. 6.0, this is a 6.2, this is an adjustment in the agenda. We're talking about audit committees. In our packet is about a lot of pages on the school audit that was finalized. Well, it's not finalized, it's in draft form for us to accept. In the past, we've had an audit committee that has reviewed the audits that comes with a recommendation for us to accept. That step was missed somewhere this year. We're forming a quick audit committee to go over the audits that have been presented. The one that's in our packet is a clean audit, if you read at least the executive summary. But a more in-depth review of that would be done by the audit committee. I know we have an obvious candidate for that committee sitting here, but I would like, if maybe somebody who's not doing budgeting and other anything else might want to jump in and be on the audit. It's a one-time meeting with a recommendation to accept probably sometime before Christmas for us to have a quick call and accept the audit at some point. Anybody interested in jumping
in? Well, in the past, I honestly thought it was the clerk because the 2 years ago, it was, you know, with yes. Not that I'm trying to.
Yeah. Always remember those things. It's the weirdest times.
No, I'm the clerk, so if.
Oh, you are?
Yes, I am. What a surprise.
Now, I have skipped over Eric here, and if you have a strong feeling that you want to be on it, it's.
I could go either way. I mean, I've read it, which is a head start at least.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If anybody wants to do it, I'm more than happy. I've got other committees I'm on. And
all right, so if you're willing. All right, so we're appointing Jeff Martin to the audit committee.
And the date for that meeting has not been set yet, right?
So. And if you can't make it, I'll go.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Guys, just yell across the street.
Yes.
Good. So that leads us to action matters, which actually ends up being another adjustment to the agenda. We are removing 7.1 for future. We're just tabling that for now. 7.2, approve a construction firm project. So you all remember that we set some money aside out of our fund balance last year for projects at the school. Anybody that's been up on the second floor of our school will know that the floor is horrible. It's actually mm-hmm. missing in a lot of places. Mm-hmm. Dave put together a proposal to have that floor replaced and the plywood underneath replaced mm-hmm. Over the Thanksgiving break, if they can get it done. Because I did not realize what kind of shape it was in until I went up for a parent-teacher conference. And there are swaths of tiles missing. Right. So what's on here is an approval for use of some of that those funds for that project. Do you want to add anything in particular?
No.
Okay.
Does that entail replacing the entire floor on the second?
The entire second floor.
That's good, because you just wonder when another section is going to deteriorate.
Yeah, no. And the floor will look a lot like what is in the front lobby now. So those, felt carpet type stuff that's industrial and replaceable. So when you buy that stuff to put down, you get 10% more to store, and then if you need it, you just tear it up and replace squares at a time.
It's made out of the same fabric as tennis balls, and it's very easy to clean, and upkeeps very well. We've been tracking how it's lasting in different rooms, and we're quite pleased.
Great.
And I could go into the more detail, or maybe you could do the first one, then I could go into the details of the different, how we're going to approach it. And what the bids are.
Yeah, so that's fine. If I could have a motion to approve the expenditure.
So moved.
I'll second it.
A second. Any further discussion? I should probably get the motion first before I have those discussions amongst myself. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, so the second part of this is that there is a contract in your packet awarding a contract to do the work to New England Floor Covering. It's a local company. It's owned by a person in Charlotte. I know that some other companies were contacted to bid. So before we start discussing, can I have a motion to approve the contract?
So moved.
And a second. Did I get a second?
Yes.
All right, mm-hmm. So Jeff's second. And further discussion. Do you want to add to anything that's in
yeah, there? So I just want to explain that. So I was trying to understand, and so I could relay it to you, that there is a need to have a new underlayment. When you look, and it means that you need to replace the plywood.
Yeah.
And what I learned is that when the washing process happens, that the plywood that's been underneath has gotten warped, and there's problems with it, and it's even
little punky in places, it is not usable. And if you want to ensure that the new floor covering will stay on, you need to have a new underlayment. So when you look at the option that is less money, it doesn't have the underlayment, so it's not really less money. So that's what I wanted to point out there.
And this goes back to our second floor of our building. It was constructed in a weird way to begin with. It was added on to, you know, just kind of plopped on top of an existing building. And if you look underneath, all it is plywood and 2x4s. So this has been coming for a while. Anyway, anything else?
Is there any concern that when they remove the plywood, they may find greater issues?
I think there's cement under there.
Yeah, so it's on top of what was before a cement roof. So if there are further issues, we can ignore them for now. Okay. They've been ignored since 1996. They can be ignored for a couple years. No, my understanding is there isn't right off the top. Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Ooh, they're going to get on the floor. They will be happy.
And the expected time what we're moving for is December break.
December break.
Oh, great. That's our hope.
Okay.
That is our hope. And okay. Just to make sure it's clear that there's so many tiles up because Dave's staff, they're pulling them up anytime they start having some bend for the safety of it. It is not that.
Yeah.
It is purposely done. It's a safety precaution. Yes.
Okay. Here we go, rolling right into the consent agenda. Can I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Do you have a second?
Second.
Does anybody have anything they want to pull out? There's not much here. All those in favor of approving the consent agenda as presented? Aye.
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 Opposed? 9.0, the next meeting date of this board is February 21st. Between now and then, there will be budget meetings of the CVSD board. That's it. Anybody else? Last director's comments? I think I skipped that last meeting. Anybody want to mention anything in particular?
I guess I just feel like every time you guys do one of these presentations, I wish more people could see them and benefit from them. So I don't want to make more work for anybody, but you know, it started when I first saw the MT, multi-tiered system of support presentation. I just wish that there's a way we could educate everybody as to what all the things that are going on as far as literacy goes, and just the language that you're using so that we could use it with our kids. You know, there's just, it's just changed so much over time, and you know, I can figure out, you know, with context clues what you're trying, you know, what those words mean in those terms, but I just wish there was a way that we could, you know, have another, not a back-to-school night, but some way to bring people together to talk about literacy or talk about math and using the terms that you're using. So.
Is there a way to cut the RETN video and post it or link to it straight off our website? Because I've told people to watch presentations that we've had before that I found
It's that extra step, though. Effective. Like, they might go to RETN and it's not live yet, or it's not posted, and then they don't go back to it. So right. It's just that whole way of keeping the communication open.
Yeah. So if there's a way to, cut out the rest of the boring part of the meeting, and
I'd say, just in light of the last meeting we had, new website for the new school district, and it's, you know. I think it's a huge opportunity to think of it differently than we do now. So, you know, that's going to be an opportunity maybe to have some input into the process. I think they're going to be soliciting ideas as we go. And I think the more, I agree with Susan, the more information, because, you know, it takes a certain level of commitment to physically show up. If you're not sure what's going to be the agenda might be interesting to you, or it just people have other commitments. That's how they get their information nowadays. They go on the internet, right? So it's a chance for us to have all sorts of stuff up there, hopefully.
I do wonder about a back-to-school night, though. I mean, I think about...
Oh. Sorry, Jeff, finish up. Sorry.
Joe, if you have a question.
I could add to the PTO news letter, which I'm doing.
Yeah.
So I could link, I mean, when this available, I don't know what is the copyright on this, whether or not I get a permission for them to say, can I just take the first 10 minutes of their section and link it to the PTO news letter, and they can just go and click on it. I mean, I do look at the statistics, and it's about 50% of the email list they do click on it. Whether they report it, I don't know.
I click it just for you.
Yeah, how many who click and who open, that kind of stuff. So
that's a good opportunity.
So I can add it to the next newsletter.
I do wonder about a back-to-school night, though, because I think about this material. I mean, these presentations, certainly the one last month as well as tonight, there's a tremendous amount of work that's going on and effort that's going on and new concepts. And while this information, I think, should be accessible online, it's pretty complex stuff. And what isn't available when you're reading, if you take the time to read through this online, are you folks to be able to ask questions and have dialogue and that exchange? And I wonder about some sort of, you're doing a lot of partnering with the PTO. I mean, I wonder about an evening where there's snacks and foods and people come in and learn about all the important work and the new, the developing philosophy in teaching methodology. This is a huge undertaking, and I think that parents would welcome, and many parents would welcome that opportunity.
I don't know if you're aware that we do a minimum of 4 or 5 of these already through the PTO, and they are nights where one of us or both of us are present. Uh-huh. We already had a climate one. And we have a proficiency-based learning one coming up, probably in about right after the break. So okay. We'll be doing a similar presentation, so that it's the exact idea you're thinking. It's about getting finding a way to bring parents in. It's connected to some kind of food and snacks usually, and it's connected also to a PTO meeting. And we have multiple vehicles to advertise it. So it's, I think we're trying to do the exact idea. Right. We had 4 last year as well, and there were curriculum topics, and it's where there's questions, Q&A, and the people who go have given us great feedback. Mm-hmm.
Okay. With that, we're going to adjourn us. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.